Are we truly Nirbhao? Are we truly Nirvair? This is a big one. Do we live in a way that says, I'm in harmony with everyone? Or do we actually live in a more realistic way? What we do is we compete with each other. We might not necessarily hate, but we say, I'm going to do a little bit better than that guy. We talked about Kartapurakh, the idea that there is a relationship between the creator and that which has been created. In fact, the relationship is so close that Kartapurakh indicates that there's no difference between one and the other. You can't separate the creator from the creation. So the creation is the creator. And the creator resides within the creation, so you can't separate the two out. So this leads quite nicely onto now what we've been covering so far being very fundamental concepts for breaking duality. Now Guruji brings in a level of duality in order to show you where you need to be. Once you understand Ik, Onkar, Sat, Naam, Karta, Purakh, all of this has been a description of the oneness. But now Nirbhao comes and brings a different element, because Nirbhao and Nirvair are always talking about the other. When you fear, you have to have someone to fear. When you hate, you have to have someone to hate. So Guruji brings in these concepts, but because the benchmark has been set with Ik Onkar, with the oneness, that's the worldview that Guruji is presenting. It now presents these ideas, which are quite common ideas in human experience, but tries to redefine them based on this non-dual experience. So we'll go on to how Guruji achieves this. So Nirbhao is broken up of two words, Nir meaning without, or no, Bhao meaning fear. Notice again the spelling. It's got an ankar underneath it, which means a singular word and a masculine word. So here, Guruji, within that whole paradigm of oneness, Guruji is introducing this idea that if all that exists is one, then there is no one to fear. If there is only one thing, then there is no one and no thing to fear. Because in order for fear to exist, there has to be two things. There has to be the one who is causing the fear and the one who is suffering the fear. So there's a duality. The one creating the fear, the one feeling the fear. But if all that exists is one thing, then fear, by default, once you understand the oneness, by default, all the fear drops. Guruji is also talking about reiterating this non-dual concept, where Guru is saying that there is no opposite to the oneness. Let's think about what we mean by that. In the Abrahamic traditions, there's been this idea that all things good is created by God and all things bad are created by some sort of Satan figure. Yeah? And so what they imply is that God has an equal and an opposite. God is all things good, and the opposite of all things good is Satan, which is all things bad. So here Guruji is saying that this is not the right way to understand the universe. The universe is only one thing, Ik. And if there's only one thing, then that one thing is responsible for all things good and all things bad. There's no dual concept. Yeah? So it breaks this idea that God is all good. Yeah, we like to think that God is all good and only good things come out of God and all the bad things come from somewhere else. Interestingly, Guru Granth Sahib Ji also talks about Satan. The word shaitan comes up. That's where we use that word. You know, you call little children shaitani, right? Shaitan comes from the word Satan. And Gurbani even says that if you do not meditate, shaitan will come and get you. It talks about Satan will come and get you. But here we have to have the use of Guru Nanak Dev Ji's ik concept to try and understand what that means. And when we look at it deeper, what we realize is that we ourselves are the Satan. The ego is Satan. The Satan is never something external to you. But if within you is Satan, within you is also the divine. Yeah? Because we never create this duality. We never create this, I am Satan and God is somewhere else, all things good. If we do that, we break Guru Nanak Dev Ji's rule. God is all good, I am all bad. So we create this duality. So within God is Satan, within Satan is God. That now brings us a whole new definition of what we think God is. Because we've created this character called God, we like to think of God as the deliverer of all things good. But when we understand there is only one thing, that one thing is responsible for everything that we call bad. All hurricanes, all tsunamis, all volcanoes, all wars, they're all contained and created by this oneness. So this oneness doesn't have this idea of good and bad. It just does things. We talked about Kartapurk, the universe just unfolding. So God has no equal and opposite. There's no separate Satan. And if God has no equal and opposite, then this oneness has nothing to fear, because how can it fear when there's only one person in the room, who can that one person be afraid of? There's nobody else there to be afraid of. Yeah? So God, this oneness, also has no other person, no other being to blame for anything. And in the same way, we have to take on that understanding. That if we are part of this oneness and the universe is all one, then there is never room for blame. Because when you blame someone, what you do is you renounce all responsibility from yourself. You say, I had nothing to do with it, that person did it. They're wrong, and by saying they're wrong, you say, I'm right. By saying I'm right and they're wrong, you create duality. So Nirbhao is as much to do with us as it is to do with the whole. Nirbhao is a characteristic we have to adopt. And we have to adopt that by understanding ek onkar, that there is only one. When there is only one, there is nothing to fear. And by saying that, there's also nothing to blame. So let's talk about this four concept. Let's talk about fear in a little more detail. And actually why Guruji introduces this idea of fear. Because you're talking about God, you're talking about this oneness, his name, his existence, it creates everything. Why talk about fear? Where does fear come into this picture? Guru Amar Das Ji says, so dare je paap kamavda. Only that person fears who commits sin. What do we mean by that? More often than not, you will fear something that you've never known. Yeah? If I put some food in front of you that you've eaten 1,000 times, you're not going to be afraid of it. If I put something that looks completely strange in front of you, something that you've never seen, never smelt, never tasted, your initial reaction will be concern, will be fear. Yeah? If it looks so completely strange and odd, So what we fear is the unknown. We always fear something that's unknown to us. And the ultimate unknown is the divine. So there's a part of us, when we go on this journey, we actually don't know what we're trying to achieve. It's something unknown to us. So even in this journey, there's a fear. There's an underlying fear that says, I think this feels right, but I don't know that it's right. My gurus have told me about this God, but there's no knowing from my side. From my side, it's an unknown. So whether we like it or not, the fact that there's an unknown means that there's a small fear that's inside of us. When Maharaj says that the oneness has Nirbhao, the reason the oneness has no fear is because it is everything. If it is everything, there is nothing outside of it. There is nothing it cannot know. So there's a direct relationship between all knowing and no fear. We talk about the oneness being antarjami. It knows everything because it is everything. If it is everything, there is nothing it cannot know about itself. And if there's nothing it cannot know, there is nothing it cannot fear. There's nothing that it can fear. How do you fear when you know everything? Like, there's no room in your house that you're afraid of, because you know every room in your house. Yeah? You go to somebody else's house, you don't know where something is, the lights are turned off, you might feel a bit, I don't know where I'm going. You're driving on a road that you've never been to before, you feel a bit tense, you feel a bit nervous because you're lost, sat nav stopped working, there's no GPS signal. You feel fearful. Yeah? It might be a small fear, but it's a fear nonetheless, because the fear is of knowing. So going back to this line, Guru Amar Das Ji, so dare je paap kamaunda. When a child makes a mistake, he knows one thing. Something is going to happen. He doesn't know what's going to happen. He might try and hide it, but he knows something is going to happen. Right?
Usually time out.
Something, right? He knows that I've done, even before. You notice a child, he makes a mistake, first thing he does, he looks around the room, just checks, did anybody catch me doing that? Now can I get away with it? Is there a way that I can cover it up? So he knows something is going to happen. He might not know what it is. So there's a knowing and then there's a not knowing. So there's a fear in there somehow. And when we commit what Maharaj is saying, so dare je paap kamaunda. When we do something wrong, even within ourselves, there's a knowing. Yeah? I know I've done something wrong. And by knowing you've done something wrong, we don't know what are going to be the consequences of this. Yeah, we don't know. So there's a fear that comes into that. How do we understand the bigger picture? Am I going to pay for this in somehow? Is someone going to find out? Yeah? Am I going to have a bad reputation because of this? So within yourselves, you know and you don't know. It's all contained within the self, knowing and unknowing. So this dual and non-dual idea is all within you. It's all relatable within you. Now you just have to multiply that, and the whole universe works in that same way. It knows, it doesn't know. There's fear, but there's no fear. So all of it is self-contained within itself. But why is Maharaj talking about fear? Let's think about this. Guru Nanak Dev Ji has introduced this idea, right? There's oneness. It's Omkar, it's sound, it's vibration, it's continuous, it's the root of everything, of all creation. Its very name is existence, is the ultimate truth. It does everything, it's the unfolding of the universe. And then he says, Nirbhao. Why does he talk about fear? There are lots of things that Guru Nanak Dev Ji could have said about this oneness. He could have said that he has no desires. He could have said that he has no anger. He's without greed. But he doesn't say any of these things. He says that this oneness is without fear. Why is fear the most important concept?
A recent study has shown that over 75% of Sikhs say that their life feels stressful or overwhelming. These feelings can develop into depression, alcohol abuse, or even suicide. We believe that Guru Nanak's wisdom can help transform people's lives. Nanak Naam relies on your donation to help create more videos and podcasts like this to educate people all over the world on how to use Guru Nanak's teachings to improve their emotional, mental, and spiritual well-being. Set up a monthly donation today and help change someone's life. Visit nanaknaam.org/donate.
In life, in our own lives, fear is the biggest driver in our life. There are only two things that drive us in life. One is love, the other is fear. Sometimes you'll hear people say, what is the opposite of love? And they say it's fear, not hate. And this is a concept that we have to understand. Fear is the reason you wake up in the morning. Let's think about this. The reason you get out of bed in the morning to get up, to get ready to go to work, why? To earn money. Why do you want to earn money? Because you know what the consequences are of not earning money. Nobody goes to work, or very few people go to work, out of love. You go to work out of fear. You get your children educated out of fear. Why? Because you know if they're not educated, you know what the consequences are. So have you ever understood that you wake up and get out of bed, your driver to get out of bed is fear? The reason, otherwise if you had nothing to fear, you'd lie in bed. The reason that you get out of bed is fear. So we now begin to understand that fear is probably the most important factor in our life. If you have family, you might get out of bed and make them something to eat. That's love. That's the other reason why you get out of bed. You either wake up and get out of bed because you have a duty to perform for someone that you love, or you have a duty to perform for something that you're afraid of because you know the alternative of not doing that. So fear is the ultimate driver in life. Let's follow the analogy of getting out of bed. You get out of bed to earn money because you know if you don't earn money, what will happen? If I don't earn money, I won't be able to pay my bills. I won't be able to buy food. I won't be able to keep this roof over my head. I won't be able to eat. Ultimately, you're saying, if I don't get out of bed and earn this money now, I won't be able to survive. Survival means that I'm trying to stay alive because I don't want the alternative. Because nobody says, if I don't eat, I won't survive, but I don't care. Because death is not a concern for me. I'm not interested so much in life. In fact, I look forward to death. That's not how we think. What we think is there's something coming, and that's the one thing we have to stay away from. So we're going to do everything to try and avoid that. So fear is the ultimate driver in life, and there is a final fear that all of us have to deal with. So now you can start to understand why fear has been introduced in something that talks about the oneness, that talks about God. Why should it talk about fear? When we started the Mool Mantar course, we said that the Mool Mantar is called Mool for three different reasons. Because it is the root definition of God, because it is the root meaning of Sikhi, and the root description that is contained in Guru Granth Sahib. But the third reason why it's called a Mool Mantar is because it is the root description of you. The whole of the Mool Mantar is a description of you. It is showing you what you are. So Ik Onkar is you. Sat Naam is you. Yeah, we talked about Sat. you're the only part of existence that you can jap naam of. Yeah? Karta purk, it is the creative being in you. It is the being that does everything in you. So nirbhao is as much about you as it is about God. In fact, you and God are the same thing. So let's quickly talk about what is fear. In order for fear to exist, you need three things. Number one, it requires a me, a self-identification, me on this side of the fence, an identification with your body and mind, this thing that we call I, me, yeah? The second thing that fear needs is you, the opposite, the other. The other has the ability to take something from you, and that's what you're afraid of, yeah? Somebody steals the camera, you can say, it's my camera. You have stolen my camera, yeah? So there is a me and there is a you. You have the ability to take something, anything away from me, and I'm afraid of that. The third thing that fear requires is an element of time. Fear is related to time. You can only fear something that hasn't happened yet. So fear is based on the future. I can't be afraid of what you did to me yesterday. Yeah, you've already done it. Yeah, if you stole an apple from me yesterday, I can't be afraid of that anymore. I can be afraid that you'll do it again. That's tomorrow. That's time. That's future. But I can't be afraid of something that you've already done. Fear requires the future. It can't be based in the past. Fear is always based on the future. So fear needs three things. Me, the other, and the future. And the interesting thing about the future is that you don't actually know that it's going to happen. Like, for example, you've stolen something from me. I know that you did it in the past, but I don't know that you're going to do it in the future. That future can never be known. So part of fear is that there's a level of unknowing. Yeah? I never know that it's going to happen again, but I'll just be afraid that it's going to happen again. So it's always an unknown. Yeah? You can never be certain it's going to happen again. So it comes back to fear being based on something based on the unknown. You always fear something that you don't know. There's a very simple way to understand fear. Fear is your body's way of telling you that you're not prepared for something. Fear is your body's way of telling you that you're unprepared. If I gave you a test right now, say, everyone, I'm going to give you a test, and I want all of you to write the alphabet A to Z. Who's going to be afraid? You're not going to be afraid, right? You'll be able to do it, easy. Yeah, because there's no unknown there. Without any preparation, I've not given you any warning, I've not given you any kind of notice that you're going to have this test, but right here, right now, if I asked you to do this test, there's no fear, because I know I can do it, I'm prepared. If I asked you to do a test on something that you've never learned before, what happens to the body? Fear, you feel cramped, you feel your heart beating faster, you might start sweating. So your body is giving you physical signs to say, you know what, something is coming that you're not prepared for. Now let's go back to the ultimate fear. If there is a part of you that is afraid of dying, it simply means that you are unprepared for dying. If your body is saying to you, this something is coming and there's no uncertainty about this. That's a definite. This is not an unknown. You don't know what death is going to be like, but you definitely know it's coming. Everyone knows. Yeah, they say there's two certainties in life, death and taxes. Two things you know you can't avoid. Death is a certainty. So it's not even an unknown, but yet we still fear it. Why? Because we're not prepared. Now you start beginning to understand where Guru is going with this. That there is the ultimate unknown, and if you have a fear of it, there is a very clear indicator from your body, from your mind, saying to you, this something is coming and you haven't prepared for it. In fact, you're running away from it. How can you run away from something that's certain? It's coming. Have you prepared for it? Can you prepare for it? How do you prepare for it? So there's a me, I am here. There is something called death, the other. I'm not dead right now, which means it's going to happen in the future. There's an element of time, and we know death is going to take something from us. In fact, it's going to take the most important thing from us. It's going to take us away from us. The me, the I, it's going to rip it out of my body. So there's a taking something away from me. So how does Mool Mantar help us deal with this? We've talked about three things that is needed in order to have fear. But what's Guru Nanak Dev Ji's magic formula? There is no three, there is no two, there's only one. So what's the one in this case? In order for there to be a fear, there has to be me and the other. Guru Nanak Dev Ji has already broken that duality. Guru Nanak Dev Ji has already explained there is no you and there is no other. Now Guru Nanak Dev Ji introduces a new concept that, so we already know there's duality between me and the other doesn't exist. We talk about that in Ekankar. Guru Nanak Dev Ji is now bringing a new element to Ekankar, saying if you're afraid of the future, the answer is ik. And the future doesn't exist. There is no future. Right now, where's the future? It's not here. It doesn't exist. There is actually no such thing as the future. It's an empty array of possibilities. Anything can happen, but there is no one definite future. So Guru Nanak Dev Ji is actually eradicating time and saying that all that exists that is certain is now. That's the only time that exists, and that's the ik. That goes back to ik. That if you look at time, what time results in ik? What is ik in terms of time? Now. There's only now. Now is the only moment that exists. So in order to be, we talked about Pao needing three things. In order to be Nirbhao, you have to eradicate those three things and bring them back to ik. Bring them back to one. There is no me. There is no you. There is no you to take something away from me. In fact, I have nothing for you to take. Everything that I have is already yours because there is no me and you. And there is no time. I have no fear of the future. And when you start doing this, what do you start doing? You start preparing for death. This is your preparation for death. Because the death is basically you saying, someone, something is going to take me away from me. Guru Nanak Dev Ji is saying, let yourself go now. Get rid of yourself now, so that when death comes, looks at you, and he's got nothing to take from you. So he just does a namaskar and walks away from you. Sukhmani Sahib says, Brahm Gyani Sad Jeeva Nahi Marta. Brahm Gyanis live forever, they do not die. Why? Because they've already died. They are Jeevat Mare. They are dead while alive. They have prepared for death by giving themselves away now, so that when death comes to take something away, he says, I can't see anything to take away from this person. When the messenger of death comes to you and they say, what am I going to take from this person? This person doesn't exist. He's gone already. Even if I take his body away, I'm not taking away anything away from him. So die such a death that the whole world will know this is the way to die. And by dying, the whole world would know this is the way to live. when you know the right way to die, you'll know the right way to live. This is preparation for death. And now when you start doing this, and this becomes your daily practice, your moment by moment, your awareness is on this, then death can no longer harm you. Nirbhao. So Nirbhao means no future. The future doesn't exist, all that exists is now. Death again is a fear of the future. You're not dying right now, you're here right now. You're not dead. So be here now. When death comes, let death worry about that. Right now you're alive, stop thinking about that. And by doing that, you're preparing for that. Yeah? By not living in the moment, when you live in the future or the past, then you're constantly living in an area which is not in the present moment. When you're in the present moment, death can't come and get you. So you see how Nirbhao is no longer God has no fear. Yeah? It's not about Mr. God anymore. Yeah? So how do you eradicate all fear? Are we trying to eradicate all fears in our life? How do you escape the self, the me, the other, time? How do you get rid of all those things? Sukhmani Sahib says, Nirbhao japa sagal pao mite. Nirbhao japa. When you know the real Nirbhao, when you understand it, when you meditate on it, then all your fears will disappear. Just on one word. Look at the power Gurbani is giving to just one word. Nirbhao japa sagal pao mite. All of your fears will disappear when you understand fear. And when you understand fearlessness, no fear, then all of your fears will disappear. Yeah, we read those and we say, oh, when you meditate on the one who is fearless, then your fears will go. No, because you've created a duality. When you understand Nirbhao, so Gurbani is saying, find the oneness in the answers to all of these things. Find the ik in all of these things. Yeah. Where there is no I, there is no other, there is no me, no you, no time, no life, no death. That's Nirbhao.
If you enjoy learning spiritual teachings and you're looking to deepen your understanding, the most effective way is to learn with a group of friends. Right now, you can set up your very own Nanak Naam meetup group from the comfort of your own homes. Gather your friends, family members or colleagues and start your very own wisdom group by visiting livingwithwisdom.org. There, you'll find a range of Nanak Naam courses designed specifically for groups that you can watch together and discuss. A growing number of people have already started their very own wisdom groups, and it's having a huge positive impact on their lives. Find out how easy it is to start your own wisdom group by visiting livingwithwisdom.org.
So what Guru Nanak Dev Ji is doing is Guruji is giving you death now. He's offering you death on a plate now. So you have to become no longer the drop of water. You have to become the ocean. In order for the drop of water to become the ocean, the drop of water has to die. But when he dies, this is not a death where you lose something. When the drop of water dies, he gains the whole ocean. He is no longer just the individual drop of water. He gains the entire ocean. So Guru Nanak Dev Ji offers you death as a solution. So we start to see that there's very strong parallels between what Guru Nanak Dev Ji is saying and what Guru Gobind Singh Ji does at Vaisakhi. You see, Guru Nanak Dev Ji says, Joto Prem Khilan Kachao, Sir Tar Tali Gali Mere Aao. Who wants to play this game is a game. This game of life, this game of love. Give your head, give me your head and walk on this path. Don't hesitate. What does Guru Gobind Singh Ji ask for? Show me some person who's willing to give their head. So there's a direct correlation. Yeah, this is now, people think that Guru Nanak Dev Ji's Sikhi is quite different to Guru Gobind Singh Ji's Sikhi. It's exactly the same. We just don't understand it. So we see Guru Nanak as a sadhu and we see Guru Gobind Singh Ji as a warrior. But they were both the same. They were both sadhu and sapai, the same. So here's an interesting one. What about fear of God? If we're talking about sagal pao mitte, getting rid of all fears, should we be afraid of God? But Barney does talk about fear of God. So what's that talking about? How can nirpo jape sagal pao mitte? It's saying all fears should be gone. It's not saying all fears should be gone except one, still be afraid of God. It's not saying that, all except one. It's not talking about that. But Barney does talk about fear of God. So what God are we talking about here? Are we talking about Mr. God? Let's go back to the Abrahamic traditions. They talk about God being a vengeful, wrathful God. God will take revenge on mankind. God gets angry at the misbehavior of man. Yeah, we see about these things like Noah's Ark and things like that. It talks about the reason God does that is he's angry at humanity. Punishing. Are we talking about a punishing God? When we still have these concepts, what we're doing is we create this duality, Mr. God. We can see massive atrocities in the world, say huge earthquakes on one part of the world, and we might turn around and say, oh, those people deserved it. God was angry at them for something. Yeah? Duality. We create this dualistic way of thinking. So we're not talking about that character. That character doesn't exist because Guru Nanak has already cleared that. Yeah? That guy doesn't exist. We're not talking about a God that gets angry. We're not talking about a God that hates. We're not talking about a God that's punishing his children. Let's look at the words that Guruji uses to describe this thing. Yeah? Sacha Sahib, Sache Nai, Pakya Pao Apar. This true master, true is his justice. His language is the words of love. We're talking about something completely different here. We're not talking about Mr. Angry here. Mr. Vengeful. Yeah? Bhakya Pao Apar. Infinite love. That's what we're talking about. That's what Guru Nanak Dev Ji is talking about. Yeah? Not about a God that will get angry at you. So how do we be afraid of God? We talk about karam. How do we understand karam? The way karam, and I think we covered this before, the way karam is sold to us, is actually sold to us from the West nowadays. Karma. Everyone talks about karma. It's like they have to tell us what the meaning of our words are. And in the West, they have a very simplistic understanding of karam. What they say is if you do something, the universe keeps a record of it, and at some point it'll do it back to you. What goes around comes around. Yeah, not at all what karam's talking about. Karam is very much understood as what you reap is what you shall sow. Yeah, you do something, like if I give you a slap in the face, either he's going to slap me back or somebody else is going to slap me back, like a like for like. Yeah, if you do something really bad, someone's going to do something really bad to you. That's how we're sold this idea of karam.
An eye for an eye.
An eye for an eye, right? It's not our concept. This is not what karam is talking about. Karam is actually a law, a cosmic law, a divine law, like gravity. And what it simply means, science is the closest when it talks about karam, is it is the law of consequences. Karam simply means everything you do has a consequence. Yeah? When scientists talk about this, they talk about action, reaction. Now, the way that this has been misinterpreted is that every action is going to have an equal and opposite reaction. Yeah? And that's what we interpret from a day-to-day basis. If I slap you, I will get a direct slap back. Yeah? Like one-to-one relationship. But that's not what karam is talking about. What karam is talking about is if I do anything to you, there will be some consequences. And those consequences are something that you're responsible for. If I say nice things to you, that might change your entire life. Yeah? And you have to carry the responsibility for that, for all of your actions. If I even say one word to you that's done in the wrong way, that one word, whether you mean it or not, can have a lifetime of consequences for another person. It doesn't mean that if I do something to you, you will do the same back to me. That's not what karma is talking about. Now when Bani talks about the weight of karma, the bar of karma, means that the consequences that you have in your life, you have to be so aware every moment what you're doing, how you're affecting people. That everything you say, everything you do will have some consequence. And all of those consequences you're directly in charge of. You can choose how you want to play this game. It's your way that you interact with the world that's going to have the consequences. So I might say something to you and that could change your entire destiny. That could change your whole life. That's my karma. So I have to choose, I have to be very careful what I say to you. Because I'm responsible for what I've done to you. You're responsible for what you do. We're all now responsible for each other. The universe, the whole world, look at the planet. Every human being is responsible for every other human being. And how we're taught this idea is, as long as you're good, you don't hurt anyone, you don't have to worry about other people. Whatever happens to them is their problem. But we're directly responsible for everyone. So when we talk about karam, let's bring it back to this fear concept. Fear, you don't fear that if I slap you, you're going to slap me. The fear has to be that I have to be so conscious at every moment of every word that's coming out of my mouth, because at any point I may say or do something that has a ripple effect on your life or the life of millions of people. Just by saying something, just by looking at you in a certain way. We've all done this. Somebody looks at you in a bad way. They don't even know that they've done it. And you go away and you think, why did he look at me like that? Why did he do this? Why did he do that? So every tiny thing can have consequences. That's what we should be afraid of. Not afraid that something's going to happen to us, but we have to be mindful of it. So if you're going to be afraid of something, be afraid of this. Be afraid of every moment there are responsibilities. Now, this is where Barney's talking about fear. Be afraid. Yeah? But not in a... But be nirbhao at the same time. Yeah? Yeah? So, Barney does talk about fear. And it talks about being fearful of God. But this is a completely different relationship. We're not afraid of this Mr. God, this angry father figure. We're not afraid of that guy, yeah? Because he doesn't exist. There's another way that Barney uses fear. And that talks about hukam. Fear has been used to directly talk about hukam. Let's talk about that very quickly. Yeah? Asadivar, you would come across this Shabad, yeah? Salok Mahalla Pahla, Asadivar, Ang 464. Pai vich pavan vahe sadbhav, pai vich chale lakh daryao. Yeah? In fear, the wind breeze blows. In fear, thousands of river flow. I'll go through all of it. In fear, fire is forced to serve. In fear, the earth is crushed under the weight of the burden of supporting the whole world. In fear, the clouds move across the sky. This is Asadiyar. In fear, the judge of Taram stands at his door, at God's door. So even Taram Raja is serving. Yeah. In fear, the sun shines. In fear, the moon reflects. And in fear, they travel millions of miles endlessly in the galaxies. In fear, the sadhus exist, the buddhas exist, the demigods and the yogis exist. In fear, all the akashic ethers, so it talks about the skies, are stretched across the whole universe. In fear, the warriors fight, the most powerful heroes exist. In fear, countless come and go. Yeah? Bayavich ave, jave pur. So loads of people come and go. So this is the system. This is not talking about the clouds are not afraid of anything. The sun and the moon is not afraid of anything. This is where Barney is talking about live in line with hukam. Yeah? That everything you have to understand hukam and you have to serve your duty while you're here. You have to serve your duty and do it consciously. Do it in a way that you don't hurt anyone, that you don't affect anyone. So So this is a very, very subtle process that Barney's talking about. Saglia pao likhya sir lekh. The inscription of fear is written upon the heads of all. On each and every one of us, fear is written. Here it doesn't mean fear. It means your duty is written. And the only fear that you need to have is that you're not following your duty. What you're here to do, do that well. Yeah? That's the fear that you have to have. Not this fear of God. Nanak Nirbhao Nirvair Sach Ek. Nanak says there's only one formless being and he is Nirbhao. He has no fear. The oneness, the ultimate oneness has no fear, but everything else has fear. Taram Raja has fear. All the sadhus, all the warriors, all the people that have ever been born and have died, all of those have done it in fear. It doesn't mean that they're afraid. It means that they just had to follow their hukum. The sun and the moon travel, the clouds, the skies. So very interesting use of the word fear. So when Barney talks about fear and it says be afraid of God, it's a completely different definition of being afraid. It's about be in line with what God has laid out for you. But because Nirbhao is so closely related to Nirvair, I want to very quickly cover Nirbhao and Nirvair together. But I'll try and keep it short. Yeah? And a lot of the same concepts you'll see exist in that as well. So Nirvair, again, awkward. Yeah? Singular, masculine word. So we talked about Satcha Sait Sajnai Bhakya Pal Apar, that this oneness only exists and talks in the language of love. So it has no hatred. Yeah? Nir means hatred. Without, Ver means hatred. And the same concepts come again. How can it hate when there's only one thing? There's nothing for it to hate. And now we take it to ourselves. Do we act in this way? Are we truly Nirbhao? Are we truly Nirvair? This is a big one. Do we live in a way that says, I'm in harmony with everyone? Or do we actually live in a more realistic way? What we do is we compete with each other. We might not necessarily hate, but we say, I'm going to do a little bit better than that guy. So we create a duality. Yeah? Competition. Yeah? Opposition. That's a big part of our life, isn't it? We have lots of friends, we have lots of family, but we all have a group of people that we don't like. Yeah? I like this guy, I like this guy, call him round, yeah, let's all have a great time, but not that guy. We all do it, right? No, you're just talking about ourselves, we all do it. Everyone says, you're looking at your phone, no, I don't like him, I don't even know why I've got his number, you know? We all have these one or two people who say, oh, I don't like that person. Opposition. Nirvair. Are you Nirvair? Or are you completely in harmony with everyone that says, I'm at peace? And the only way to be Nirbhao Nirvair is to be at peace with yourself. When you're at peace with yourself, why? Because there is no one that can take anything away from you. Why don't you want to bring that person into the room, the person that you don't like? Because you're afraid they'll take something away from you. If nothing else, they'll take your shanti away from you. So when I see that person, he makes me angry and I don't want to be angry. He's taking my tranquility. I'm happy right now. He's going to take my happiness away. You're afraid of him. You're afraid of that other person because when he comes into the room, I feel angry. I don't want to feel angry. So he takes your anger away from you. So we don't act in this way. Yeah, you see the Nirbhao and Nirvair, that's why they're put together. They're so intertwined. And in order to fear, you needed three things. The same three things you need to have hatred. You need to have a me, I'm the good one. You're the bad one because you did something bad to me. And now instead of future, hatred is always based on the past. You can't hate someone you've never met. Someone you've never met, you've never known, don't know anything about them. You can't hate them. Why? Because they've not had a chance to do anything to you yet. You could be afraid of them because you don't know what they're going to do. That's fear. But you can't hate them until they do something to you. Once they've done something to you, it's in the past. Once they've done something to you, it's in the past. Hatred is always in the past. Fear is always in the future. Nirbhao Nirvair.
So sometimes Nirvair leads to... Sorry, Var leads to Po.
Of course. Yeah. Why else can you hate someone?
Forever in the past. Yeah.
You're only going to hate someone because they did something in the past. And you'll hate them even more if there's a chance that they'll do it again, so you're afraid.
Have you found that spiritual teachings are great to learn, but not always easy to apply to your own life? Sometimes we all need a bit of support and guidance from people who know what we're going through and can help us find some answers. The Nanak Naam Facebook group helps you do just that. It's an online community where you can ask any questions about life and get answers from other members of the group. Search for Nanak Naam Community Support and join our free Facebook group today.
How do you get rid of hatred? There has to be no me, there has to be no you, and there has to be no past. So interestingly, now what Guru Nanak Dev Ji is doing is introducing a whole new level here. Because what Guru Nanak Dev Ji is saying is, Ikonkar means there's no future and there's no past, there's only now. So he's bringing an element of time, which he didn't do so far. Yeah? Because the words so far were like, Kartapurak, Onkar is timeless, Atnam is all timeless concepts. Nirbhao and Nirvair are very much rooted in time. Bani is saying that be Nirbhao. Be a person for whom future is irrelevant. Be Nirvair. Be a person for whom the past is irrelevant. And for a person who has no past, who has no future, what do they have? They have now. Right here, right now, I'm in bhakti. That's all I need to know. I might not be in bhakti tomorrow, but that's not my problem. Let's see what happens tomorrow. Guru Nanak Dev Ji is introducing very beautiful concepts of time and how do we relate to time. So if you're feeling fear, you know the solution now. You know what the causes of that fear is. You know, there's three things that are happening right now. There's a me, there's a something I'm afraid of, and there's an element of future. How do I get rid of it? Nirbhao jape sagalpo mite. Let me remember the true meaning of Nirbhao. Sit here, be in my Nirbhao state. Be in the state of meditation, of now. And in right here, right now, you know, you notice when you're meditating, it's very much in the moment. Just that word that's coming out of your mouth is important. You don't even think about the last word that you said and you're not focused on the next word that you're going to say. Just the word, the sound, that very moment that it's happening right now is how you meditate. You meditate in the moment. You nam jap in the moment. When you nam jap in the moment, you instantly break all future and all past. You just are in that middle path. But that's all nice and flowery. That all sounds very romantic. How do you deal with someone you don't like? Because we all have those people. You know, I bring that person into the room right now, sit them in front of you, how do you deal with them? You have to deal with them in the same way by identifying the three things. One, let me, just for a moment, let myself go. Because by holding on to the hatred that you have for someone else, what you're really holding on to is the suffering that they've caused you. They've caused you pain. You're holding on to that. So firstly, let yourself go. Free yourself from the pain. So you know what? I understand the pain that you've caused me. Just for a moment, it might not go for the rest of my life. For a moment right here, like right now, let me forget that. Secondly, let me look into your eyes and not see the person who's caused me the hate. Let me see my Master, my creator, let me see the one. Third, let me forget about time. Let me forget about the event that's happened. So you have to get rid of all three things. You have to get to a point where every solution to all your problems is solved by the answer of ik. Right here, right now, you don't exist, I don't exist, the past doesn't exist. There's just two people in a room, and in fact, there aren't two people. We're both the same thing. You have to bring everything. Otherwise, what happens? You bring the person in front of you and your mind goes crazy. Oh no, how do I get out of this room? Oh, they did this to me. I hope they don't do that to me. I hope he doesn't talk to me. What if he says this to me? What if he starts an argument? I should say something first. Your mind goes in all directions. He hasn't even said anything, he's just walked into the room. Your mind goes in all directions, yeah? Worry, fear, anxiety, all those kind of things. You have to contain all of that. That's why you have. That's why Naam Simran has to be done when you don't have problems in your life. Yeah? People start doing Naam Simran when they have problems in their life, then they're not doing Naam Simran, then they're actually problem solving. When you do Naam Simran, when you don't have any problems in your life, when the problems come, you know how to deal with them. When the person walks into the room, you contain yourself. Gather everything, all your thoughts and everything, bring it right down to this one moment, right here, now. I know how to solve this problem. And I just sit here and I meditate. When I meditate, the problem goes away. The person doesn't go away. But what you've got is you've got an oppressor, you've got somebody who is oppressing, you've got somebody who's being suppressed, yeah? You've got time, you've got, he said this to me and blah, 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 all these kind of things. These thoughts start whizzing around in your head. Contain them all. Literally see yourself like a Hoover, like a vacuum. You just suck up all your thoughts, bring them back down. Right here, right now, he's not doing anything to me. Contain. This is how. Look at the great history that we have. Look at the great shaheeds that we have. Look at the great shaheeds. Look at Baba Mani Singh Ji. He's just sitting there. You know, Baba Mani Singh Ji, so many members of his family were made shaheed. Or some ridiculous number, like 40, 50 members of his family were made shaheed. You know? And he's sitting there saying, yeah, start with that one. You know, my time has come. Start chopping away. He says to the executioner, do your job properly. You were told to chop me limb from limb. The executioner was going to chop his wrist off first. He said, do your job properly. Your job was limb from limb. My first limb is this joint here. Start from there. Why? Because he understood fear. He understood that we talked about fear before, about how the universe, the suns and the moons all exist in fear. That's talking about hukam. Baba Mani Singh Ji is saying to the person, your job is to be an executioner. Chandidara Kamkar, do it properly. Do your job properly. Start from there. You can only do that when there's no part of you left. He has no time. He has no element. He has no relationship with his body. No past, no present, no future. No love, no hate, nothing. He's just fine. Just in that moment, he's just doing Naam Simran. So talk about, what about just a random person who's done something? What have they done? Maybe they smashed your car or something. They drove into your car or something. You know, they said some bad things to your family, or they did some. What's the worst that somebody can do? And even if you can imagine the worst thing, right here, right now, you have to be able to deal with it, because that event has happened. Either you're going to carry that with you, or you're just going to accept it, move on, be in hukam, be in the moment now. These are not easy concepts, yeah? So these ideas of Nirbhao Nirvair, they're intertwined. There's a lot in, you know, information in here. But this goes to show how Nirbhao Nirvair is so closely related to you. He's no longer about John, no longer about Mr. God. That guy is irrelevant. We're talking about you and your relationship and your mindset and how you should live. So remember the three things. In order to have fear, in order to have hatred, there's a you, the victim, there's the suppressor, and there's an element of time. Bring all of those, contain all of those. No time. Yeah. Notice how we go on to that. Yeah? Nirbhao, Nirvair.
Akal
Murat. Time comes immediately after Nirbhao, Nirvair. Yeah? Timelessness. Deathlessness. You see how one concept just flows quite neatly into the next one. Yeah? So I'll leave you with a couple of very small anecdotes, little stories that allow you to see how to deal with this in real life. Buddha is teaching a class, sitting down, meditating, teaching a class full of people. A man walks past, spits in Buddha's face and walks away. All of his students get up and get really angry. Oh, how can you do this? He's our master, all that sort of stuff. Buddha says, sit down. And they can't understand, why have you not got angry? Guys just walk past and spat on your face. His first reaction is, firstly, it happened to me, not to you, calm down. didn't happen to you, happened to me. Secondly, the guy has come, he's done whatever he needed to do, and maybe there was a reason. Maybe there's some reason. Yeah, maybe it's something that I've done to him that he had to balance it out. Yeah? But right here, right now, I'm not affected by it. Yeah? Maybe whatever tiny bit of relationship that needed to happen between me and him, karam had to end, had to finish something off. Yeah, that he had to do that. But do you see how he doesn't take any responsibility? He doesn't say it's my fault, I must have done something wrong, because there's an ego. Yeah, there's an ego in saying, I must have done something. And there's an ego in saying, oh, look how great and sadhu I am, I'm not doing anything. He's none of those. He's just free from it. He's just completely impartial. Be impartial to your own life. Be impartial to your own life. Second story. Two monks, sounds like a start of a joke. Two monks are walking down the road, right? They come across a river and they see an old lady standing there. One of the monks picks up the old lady, puts her on his back, crosses the river, drops the lady down, and they carry on walking. The old lady couldn't cross the river. They're walking. Half an hour later, the other monk says, sorry, I have to stop you. I need to ask you this question. He says, you and me are monks, and we have vowed to never touch a woman in our life. That's our vow, that's our dharam, that's our religion. We've decided that we will never touch a woman in life. Why did you pick that woman up? He said, I picked that woman up, took her across the river, put her down. He says, why are you still carrying her? I'm the one that picked her up. I crossed the river, I put her down. Why are you still carrying her? Because for half an hour, I've not been thinking about this woman, but you've been thinking about this woman. So it's not about action. It's about mindset. And this is what we do with people we don't like. Somebody has done something to you maybe 10 or 20 years ago. You're still carrying it. They're not doing it to you. They're not doing it to you now. Remember this. When somebody walks into the room and you think about them, and you are thinking, I don't like that person, I don't like that person, I don't like that person, what does that sound like? It sounds like a mantra. What you're actually doing is meditating on that person. Now ask yourself, do you want to meditate on that person? Until that person leaves the room, you're meditating on that person.
You're giving them full attention.
And even when they go, you're still doing the altar.
Even when they leave the room, let's say they haven't said anything to you, you're still meditating on them.
Oh man.
That's what Simran means. You're meditating on your awareness is fully on this person. Now, do you love them that much that you want to meditate on them all the time? We don't meditate on the people that we love that much, but we meditate on the people that we hate. Something to think about. Nirbhao Nirvair, not easy concepts, but you have to know what it's doing to you. It's doing this to you. And you're, imagine like they say that like, you're renting out your brain to that person. They've fully moved in. They've moved into this apartment space. They're rented, yeah? They're taking up all the accommodation in your head. Is that what you want? The solution is Naam Simran. The solution is Ik. Look at, Pai Gurdas Ji says, Waheguru Guru Mantar hai jap homme khui. Waheguru is a mantar. Keep doing it, your ego goes. It's quite simple, really. But doing it is hard. It's not easy. It's a lot easier to meditate on other people. Look how much time. Nindya is like one of the biggest no-nos in Gurbani. It says, don't do Nindya. What are you doing? When you say, that guy is really bad, secretly what you're saying is, at least I'm not doing what he's done. And by saying that, by saying somebody is bad, what you're saying is, I am good. By saying, I am good, you retain your ego. doing nindya of someone, slandering someone, is like the worst thing that Barney says to do. Not because it affects the other person, because it affects you. It affects you. You're meditating on that person and you're increasing your own ego. Oh, I'm better than that person. That person is terrible. That person is terrible. Yeah? You're increasing your ego because you're secretly saying, I'm okay. At least I'm not as bad as that person. I'm okay. Yeah, I'm a good person. Keep doing that. All your meditation goes down the drain. So these are practical steps, yeah? Practical steps to try and understand these very almost theoretical concepts. And hopefully we can see how do we do these things. But the solution is always Naam Simran. The answer is always Ik. And hopefully as every week goes on, you'll see how Ik is so profound. How is the ultimate concept of everything. It's the answer to a lot of our problems.
Answer the following questions, either by writing them down or discussing them in your groups. When have your fears held you back from doing something you wanted to do? How can we realistically become fearless in a world filled with uncertainties and challenges? How does oneness change your ability to forgive others and let go of anger? Is it possible to be ambitious in life without having rivalry and seeing others as your competition?